What you are looking at is a visual comparison of AMD's last three Ryzen generations. From left to right, we have Zen 2 in the form of a Ryzen 5 3600, Zen 3 as a Ryzen 5 5600, and a Zen 4 based Ryzen 7 7800X3D. That's three CPU generations on two different sockets with some pretty substantial changes in technology and performance. But looking at these gorgeous near-infrared pictures from Fritzchen's Fritz, it's difficult to spot any visual differences. 3600 and 5600 are pretty much identical, and the main visual difference of the 7800X3D is not the chiplets, but rather the capacitors surrounding it. All three CPUs basically look the same, one large I/O die and a single CPU chiplet with room for one more. That's because ever since the introduction of Zen 2 in 2019, the interconnect and packaging design of AMD's Ryzen CPUs hasn't changed at all. And from what we know, Zen 5 will still use this very same design. They say don't fix what ain't broken, but after soon to be 4 generations on the same chiplet architecture, it's time for something new. Zen 6 is supposed to introduce sweeping changes to layout, packaging, and interconnect design. But what exactly is supposed to change? Which technologies could be used, and how will Zen 6 benefit? Zen 2 wasn't only the first mass market chiplet architecture, it was arguably the most impactful one, even though its interconnect and packaging technologies are rather simple. Instead of using complex and expensive technologies, AMD is connecting the individual chiplets by running traces through the PCB, something that has been done in semiconductors for many decades and isn't only easy to implement, but also a flexible and very cost-effective way to design a multi-chip module. This image of a Zen 2 PCB shows all the traces within the 12-layer substrate. And while it might look complex at first, once you quite literally connect the dots, the simplicity becomes apparent. We can make out the area for the two CPU chiplets in the upper half of the PCB and the I/O die below that in the center. The CPU chiplets are only connected to the I/O die. All of the other traces are routed directly from and to the I/O die, which handles input and output, such as system memory and PCI Express. Even though the CPU chiplets are placed in close proximity to each other, they are not directly connected. Every communication has to go through the I/O die first. Yes, there are many traces on the PCB, but the technology behind them is simple. On face value, it's literally just tiny copper wires embedded into the PCB, not unlike your motherboard or any other electronic device with a printed circuit board. Sometimes PCBs are also called printed wiring boards, which I feel like is an even more fitting name, as they are a medium used to connect different components with tiny wires. That's the technology AMD has been using for its breakthrough chiplet architecture and is still using today. Even the Infinity Fabric protocol that is used to transfer the data over those wires is based in large parts on PCI Express, a proven technology. But this simplicity doesn't come without drawbacks. Transporting data via the PCB results in low bandwidth, high latency, and also consumes a lot of energy. It's so simple to design and cheap to produce because it's a low-tech implementation. The positive aspects are only related to the cost side. Performance and efficiency take a backseat. Going forward, AMD needs an interconnect technology that is able to meet the demands of future Ryzen and EPYC generations. More bandwidth, lower latency, and reduced energy cost when transporting data. On the flip side, this new technology will certainly be more expensive to design, implement, and manufacture. Let's take a look at the available options, weigh their pros and cons, and see which ones make the most sense for Zen 6. The most advanced interconnect technologies use so-called silicon interposers, which are pieces of silicon placed in between the substrate and the chiplets. This image from TSMC depicts their CoWoS technology, but it's true for any other silicon interposer packaging method. Funny enough, the image on the left looks strikingly similar to AMD's current chiplet design. Maybe the one on the right shows its future? The advantage of a silicon interposer is that instead of using copper wires on the PCB, the chiplets are sitting on top of the same piece of silicon, which means data connections between chiplets never have to leave the silicon. Running data path through silicon allows for a much higher interconnect density, resulting in more bandwidth and lower latency, while at the same time also using less energy, because interposers provide a much larger channel for electrical signals, reducing the amount of energy needed to drive the data signals. AMD's current low-tech solution uses around 1.5 to 2 picojoules per bit, while a silicon interposer interconnect is in the ballpark of around 0.2 to 0.5 picojoules per bit, a huge increase in power efficiency. So you get higher bandwidth, lower latency, and it uses less energy. What's not to like? Well, there's a trade-off. This time the solution is high-tech, but the costs are high too. Not only does it take more engineering resources to design and implement a silicon interposer design, but the interposer itself also doesn't come cheap. Size is a problem too, as the silicon interposer has to be big enough to fit a large number of chiplets. This requires special technology, so-called mask stitching, to produce interposers above the current EUV reticle limit of 858 mm², which further increases costs. The packaging also requires more precision, since the interposer is very fragile and easily breaks. And then you have to completely rethink your power and data routing, since you can't just connect straight to the chiplets because the interposer is in the way. For that, you need so-called TSVs, through-silicon vias, another cost factor. In a nutshell, silicon interposers are great from a pure performance and efficiency perspective, but they are also very complex and expensive to implement. Especially in today's market, manufacturing capacities are limited due to the huge demand for AI GPUs like NVIDIA's H100 and AMD's MI300, which all use silicon interposers. AMD clearly has the ability to produce complex interposer designs, but in my opinion, it's not a feasible solution for the consumer market and even HPC CPUs. Zen 6 very likely won't use a silicon interposer. The next best thing are so-called silicon bridges, with Intel's EMIB being the most famous technology of this type. The idea behind silicon bridges is pretty simple: achieve the same benefits of a silicon interposer at lower complexity and lower cost. So how do you do that? The name is a pretty good description of the concept. Instead of one large interposer that covers all of the chiplets you want to connect, you place smaller pieces of silicon right where two chiplets meet. Intel's EMIB, which is short for Embedded Multi-Die Interconnect Bridge, places the silicon bridge inside the package substrate, while other solutions like InfoLSI or CoWoS-L from TSMC raise the silicon bridge above the substrate, a technology used for AMD's MI200, where it was dubbed Elevated Fanout Bridge. In theory, a silicon bridge offers similar benefits to a silicon interposer without the high costs a single piece of silicon incurs, and the smaller bridges also don't block the access to the individual chiplets from below, reducing the use of expensive TSVs. But placing the silicon bridges isn't easy, especially when you need a lot of them, like when connecting multiple CPU chiplets with multiple I/O dies. Each placement becomes a potential point of failure during packaging. If one interconnect fails, the whole chip might be wasted. A while back, Tom from Moore's Law is Dead leaked early Zen 6 design abstractions. In his video, which I've linked below, he showed slightly altered versions of internal AMD slides, outlining the layout of Zen 6-based server CPUs. In Tom's video, we can see a combination of closely connected I/O dies and CPU chiplets, which at first glance look very similar to a silicon bridge implementation. The chiplets are placed right next to each other, and the interconnect area seems to overlap, resembling an embedded or elevated bridge. There are a few options for AMD to choose from if they want to use silicon bridges. TSMC offers the already mentioned InfoLSI and CoWoS-L, which are basically the same technology with a different order of packaging. Integrated fanout, or INFO, is a chip-first process, where the chips are placed first and then the interposer or bridge layer is built up second. CoWoS is a chip-last process, where the interposer or bridge layers are built up first and then the chips are connected in a second step. Placing the chips last is more easy on the chips, which makes it more valuable for fragile chips like HBM. That's why basically all HBM-based chips are using CoWoS packaging technology. Since Zen 6 very likely won't use HBM, a INFO variant would be the more likely choice for AMD. And TSMC isn't the only provider. Outsourced semiconductor and test companies offer similar technologies, in the case of AES, for example, Focus Bridge. The point is, using a silicon bridge technology wouldn't be limited by high CoWoS demand, and there are other providers aside from TSMC. As such, a silicon bridge is a much more likely contender for Zen 6 interconnect technology. It offers similar benefits as an interposer, while at the same time reducing some of its greatest drawbacks. And while I wouldn't be completely surprised to see a bridge interconnect used for Zen 6, there's one more technology that I personally consider to be the most likely contender for AMD's next-gen chiplet design. A organic redistribution layer, RDL for short, with a fanout interconnect. This technology takes a page out of the silicon interposer playbook by also building up an interposer that sits below all the chiplets. But instead of using silicon as the material of choice, other organic compounds are used, mostly composite materials. The idea is simple. To achieve benefits like higher bandwidth, lower latency, and especially more energy efficiency, you need to increase interconnect density, so you can create larger channels for electric signals. Basically, you need to create more space for more interconnects. Yes, silicon would be the perfect material for such a solution, but as we discussed before, silicon is expensive and comes with a lot of other packaging-related drawbacks. If you are using a less capable material, the benefits won't be as great, but you can still achieve a more dense connection nonetheless. And AMD already has experience with organic interposers. Both Navi 31 and 32 use a form of TSMC's InfoR, short for Integrated Fanout RDL, sometimes also called InfoOS for on-substrate. AMD calls it Infinity Links. Here's how it works. A organic RDL interposer with at least 4 layers is placed below the GCD and the MCDs. At the intersection of each chip, the RDL is used to quite literally fan out the interconnects onto a much larger area, which wouldn't be possible without the extra space the RDL interposer creates. It's called fan out because instead of straight point-to-point connections, these high-density interconnects look like an old-fashioned folding fan. This visual comparison by AES is pretty good at explaining how fan-out works. On the left, you can see a standard fan-in, where the traces are routed within the area of the chip, which means the chip itself limits how many interconnects you can create. Fan-out on the right side shows that traces are routed outwards from the chip to build connection points beyond the limit of the individual chip. And now imagine the effect you can create when you have more than one layer available. The interconnect density greatly increases. AMD claims that these infinity links offer about 10 times the bandwidth density of Infinity Fabric on package, with a staggering 5.3 terabytes per second, and also reduce power consumption by up to 80% at the same time. In their RDNA 3 presentation, AMD even compared a current gen EPYC CPU using Infinity Fabric to their new Infinity Links, which is a pretty huge hint in my opinion. On the left we can see 25 wires on a standard organic package, like used by Infinity Fabric. And the tiny image on the right shows 50 wires using the new Infinity Link technology with an organic interposer. The images are to scale, so you can see how much smaller and much more dense the Infinity Links actually are. The difference is staggering. Of course, an organic interposer also comes with some of the same drawbacks as a silicon one. But just like the performance benefits, the drawbacks are also less pronounced. Like CoWoS, Info also offers large interposers, multiple times the EUV reticle limit, which should be enough for even a Zen 6-based EPYC server CPU. Just like a silicon interposer, a organic RDL is also somewhat blocking access to the dies from below, as it sits in between the substrate and the chiplets. But it's also easier to run connection through organic material. In a nutshell, a organic interposer with fan-out interconnects strikes a perfect balance. It offers higher bandwidth, lower latency, and better energy efficiency compared to the current Infinity Fabric on package, while its downsides are not as pronounced as with a silicon interposer, meaning costs are manageable. Navi 31 and 32 are proof that AMD can scale such a technology for standard consumer products without hurting margins. In the end, TSMC's InfoR is the most likely contender, but solutions such as Focus from AES are also a possibility. A organic interposer is definitely my number one contender for AMD's next-gen chiplet interconnect architecture. Now, let's assume Zen 6 will replace the current Infinity Fabric interconnects with Infinity Links, similar to Navi 31 and 32. What would the actual benefits be and how different would the packaging and layout look like? For desktop Ryzen CPUs, the most obvious change would be the placement of the CPU chiplets. Instead of being located away from the I/O die, they would sit right next to it, either one on each side or both on the same side, depending on how AMD designs the desktop I/O die. When it comes to benefits like bandwidth latency and efficiency, desktop Ryzen parts will see the most benefit from a decrease in latency. Just like Zen 3 improved latency by switching to a unified 32 MB L3 cache instead of two separate 60 MB blocks on Zen 2, Infinity Links will cut down the latency between I/O die and CPU chiplets, improving performance in latency-dependent applications like gaming. With only dual-channel DDR5 and not that many cores to feed, bandwidth isn't a problem to begin with. And while a more efficient interconnect is always nice to have, it's also not a major concern for Ryzen. It's the latency that will elevate Zen 6 on desktop. Servers, on the other hand, are a whole different ballgame. With EPYC, the most important improvement will be the increased interconnect efficiency. Connecting 16 or more chiplets with Infinity Fabric on package consumes a large portion of the total TDP. Infinity Link would drastically reduce the amount of energy required for the interconnects, either enabling a lower TDP or leaving headroom for more cores and higher clock speeds. I'm pretty sure AMD will spend every additional watt on more cores. Zen 5 is already rumored to scale up to 128 standard and 192 compact cores. Zen 6 could go well beyond that with a new interconnect design. And when it comes to servers, bandwidth is also an important factor. First of all, servers have a lot more memory channels to feed its many cores. And server CPU chiplets also contain more cores. Zen 4C increased core count per chiplet to 16. And by Zen 6, we might even see 24 or 32 core chiplets. These cores need a lot of bandwidth when communicating with the I/O die. Infinity Link would be a huge boon. Zen 2 was a breakthrough for AMD, and its legacy is still felt today, especially the Infinity Fabric on Package interconnect AMD has been using ever since. It's actually crazy to think that Zen 5, which will release later this year, is still going to use the same technology. AMD's next gen interconnect will be more expensive, but deliver important benefits across the board. Higher bandwidth, lower latency, and increased energy efficiency will allow AMD to scale their chiplet architectures even further, while reducing the performance drawbacks introduced with Zen 2. There's always the slight chance that AMD will implement different solutions for client and desktop, for example a more expensive silicon bridge interconnect for EPYC and an organic RDL for Ryzen. But going by AMD's previous track record, they like to keep it simple, which is why I think we will see the same technology on all chiplet platforms. I'm convinced that an organic interposer solution, such as TSMC's InfoR, used by Navi 31 and 32, is the most likely contender for AMD's next-gen chiplets. It's cheaper than silicon-based interconnects, while still offering strong benefits over the current solution. AMD's Infinity Links will be the future. I would like to know what kind of interconnect technology you would like to see. Intel is going straight to silicon interposers with Meteor and Arrow Lake. Should AMD do the same, or is a balance of cost and performance the better choice? Let me know in the comments below. I hope you found this video interesting, and see you in the next one.